All right, everybody, I think we can get proceedings underway. Thank you very much again for joining us. I will let people in as they join. But it is now my pleasure to play a short video encouraging you all to please participate in a very important fundraising activity, a coronavirus appeal run by the South African Zionist Federation in collaboration with the South African Friends of Israel.
For over 100 years, South African Zionist Federation has been the bridge between South Africa and Israel, bringing the best of the Holy Land to the beloved country, and vice versa. That's why, during this time of unprecedented corona crisis, the Fed is working tirelessly to access the latest medical technology from Israel, so that we can contribute to the national fight against COVID-19. Just recently, for example, the SAZF partnered with Israeli startup Sanovia Tech to donate cutting-edge medical masks to Hatzolah Medical Rescue. And the Israeli-developed Chagai volunteer food delivery application is being used with great success to facilitate food deliveries within the Jewish community. Meanwhile, the SAZF's flagship program, South African Friends of Israel, is also stepping up to the plate. SAFI is an organization dedicated to creating a united coalition with other religious, cultural, and ethnic groups in the interests of building a broader grassroots support base for Israel in South Africa. SAFI's activities include combating BDS and other delegitimization campaigns, hosting events and gatherings for a diverse community of pro-Israel advocates, and supporting public figures, such as the Chief Justice of South Africa, who have come under fire for their views. Now, in this time of pandemic, our friends and supporters need our help. That's why SAFI has been busy organizing food parcels and feeding schemes, offering a much-needed lifeline to thousands of people who are going hungry as a result of the ongoing pandemic. With no jobs, no food, a deteriorating economy, and bitter winter weather, the situation really is dire. So please, let's come together as a community to help the Fed and SAFI keep hunger at bay. You can show your support by making a deposit into our dedicated coronavirus fund. No amount is too small, and every cent we raise will go towards putting food on the tables of our society's most vulnerable members. Make your donation now using these payment details. Be a light unto the nations by making your contribution today. And please, share this video to spread the word about Israeli tech fighting COVID-19. The South African Zionist Federation and South African Friends of Israel, making a difference where it matters most.
Thank you very much. Please, if you can, make any kind of donation, no matter how big or small, there are the details. Every cent will make a real difference. It is now my great pleasure to introduce Esther Levitas, Chairman of the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council, to give a short welcome. I remind all our speakers to please unmute themselves before they start talking.
Thanks. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome you and to another fascinating webinar offered by the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council. The topic of this evening is an episode in our history that is often overlooked, dealing with the flight of the Jews from Arab countries. We are indeed honored to have Lyn Julius addressing us, and welcome everybody again.
Thank you, Esther. I'd now like to introduce Rodney Masinta, Vice Chair of the South African Cape Council, South African Zionist Federation Cape Council, and the Media Chair to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, David. Good evening, everybody. And particularly good evening to Lyn. When we think of persecution of Jews, our minds as a rule turn historically to Europe, Russia, and ending in the Holocaust. Our speaker today turns a lesser known and two infrequently discussed Jewish experience of violent discrimination. About the Jews of Africa and the Middle East. In addition to being a journalist and a blogger, our distinguished speaker is the founder of Harif, the UK Association of Jews from the Middle East and North Africa. In her book, Uprooted, she relates how 3,000 years of Jewish civilization in the Arab world vanished virtually overnight. In exploring the history, she poses a number of incisive questions. For instance, who are the Jews from Arab and Muslim-dominated countries? What were relations with Muslims like? What made Jews leave countries where they had been settled for thousands of years? And what lessons can we learn from the mass exodus of minorities from the Middle East? Our speaker undertakes to answer all of these questions and more. Ladies and gentlemen, Lyn Julius.
Thank you very much indeed for that introduction, Rodney, and thank you to Esther. I'd also like to thank Galia, who introduced me to the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council. We actually met in Inverness in Scotland, which is an unlikely place, but with Zoom, it's amazing how one can meet again. So good evening, and thank you very much for having me. I'm delighted to be talking to you about my book, Uprooted, and about the question of the forgotten Jewish refugees from Arab countries. I am actually the daughter of Jewish refugees from Iraq, from Baghdad. They came to the UK in 1950. They were in a small minority of Jews from Iraq who didn't actually go to Israel, because 90% of the community left at that time. I was growing up, and even the story of the Jew really haunted me, because I still had relatives who lived in Baghdad. I had some cousins and aunts and uncles, and I had my four grandparents. And so my family were extremely concerned about these relatives in Iraq. In 1967, things took a turn for the worse. Those of you who are old enough to remember the Six-Day War, a wonderful victory for Israel, was a catastrophic defeat for the Arab countries. And the regime in Iraq actually turned against the few thousand Jews who were still living there. And they sacked them from their jobs. They froze their bank accounts. They cut off their telephones. The young people were not allowed to go to university. And above all, nobody could leave the country. They were hostages. And before long, the regime started accusing the 3,000 or so Jews who were still left in Iraq out of an original community of 150,000. The regime started accusing them of spying for Israel. So there followed arrests, people were put on trial, and in 1969, nine Jews were executed in Liberation Square in Baghdad. And that was just the start, because 50 Jews were picked off the streets, were jailed, and were never seen again. And this was a massive shock to such a small community.
they were absolutely desperate to get out. And eventually they did in about 1970. And because leaving the country was illegal, they were actually smuggled out. And this smuggling operation took place in the dead of night. People left their homes. They locked their front doors as if they were going on holiday with one suitcase. They were smuggled through the north of Iraq with the help of the Kurds. But all this operation was actually masterminded by Israel. My aunt was amongst those who were smuggled out. She was disguised as an Arab lady with an abaya. And the Jews finally made it across the border into Iran, which was then, amazingly enough, friendly to Israel. And from there, they went to Israel, or they went to the UK, or wherever. So this whole story is not really known, and certainly was one of the reasons why I decided to write my book. About 15 years ago, I set up the organization Harif, which Rodney was kind enough to mention. You don't have to be a Jew from the Middle East to join it. We have plenty of Ashkenazi members, and we also have Christians and Muslims. The object of this organization, Harif, was really to raise awareness of the history and culture of the Jews from the Middle East and North Africa. And this we were doing through talks and film screenings, debates, book launches, whatever. Of course, all that is impossible in the current climate with coronavirus. So we've gone online, and I'm pleased to say we've been busier than ever doing Zoom events like you have. And I think we've done about 17, one a week, on different aspects of history and culture. And you're all welcome to join these events. All you have to do is subscribe to the website harif.org. Now, as concurrently with my Harif activities, I started a blog called Point of No Return, which you can find quite easily on Google, Point of No Return blog. And I've accumulated about 6,000 posts. And these were basically articles, you know, any kind of material I found online, some of it original. So this became an archive of information about Jews from the Middle East and North Africa. And about 10 years after doing this, I thought, well, wouldn't it be nice to perhaps write a book, drawing together sort of the main themes that, you know, that I had learned while I'd been blogging. And basically, I found that, that there were certain myths that needed addressing, myths that you might find occur every day if you're active in advocating for Israel. And I found these myths really, once you dispelled them, you managed to explode practically all the myths that you're faced with, all the lies that you might encounter in your everyday advocacy. For instance, Jews are interlopers from Europe. They're all white Europeans. Wrong. Most Jews in Israel actually descend from refugees from Arab and Muslim countries, or were refugees themselves. And those people never actually left the Middle East. They're actually indigenous to the region. Another myth, for instance, everything was perfect between Jews and Muslims until Israel came along in 1948 and spoilt a harmonious relationship. Anyway, but I would like to actually show you this PowerPoint presentation, which explains the main points in my book. The main focus is, of course, the 850,000 Jewish refugees from Arab countries. And this number is actually larger than the number of Palestinian refugees who left Israel. And it's the largest number of non-Muslim refugees before 2003, when there was a mass exodus of Christians from Iraq after the American invasion. And their numbers have gone down from 1.5 million to about 200,000 today. And the reason why the Jewish refugees are so important is not because it's sort of an incidental, it's incidental to the history of this region. It's really central because it's the key to understanding the Middle East conflict, in my opinion. And it's also the key to peace, because over 50% of Jews living in Israel do come from this part of the world. And any peace that ignores their history and their quest for justice would not be based on truth and would not foster reconciliation. So the book actually covers 10 Arab countries, as you can see from this map, Morocco in the far west, right through to Yemen in the far east. I do not actually cover Iran very much, although I do touch on Iran, because my main focus is really the exodus, the mass exodus of Jews from Arab countries that occurred immediately after 1948. The exodus from Iran took place about 30 years later, when the Ayatollahs took over after the Islamic Revolution. And there too, the Jewish population has declined dramatically from 100,000 in 1979. It's down to about anything between 5 and 8,000. Just to give you an idea of how dramatic the population in Arab countries has declined, you can see that from this chart that the Jewish population in Europe during World War II actually declined less precipitously than the Jewish population in Arab states. So that has gone down from nearly a million to barely 4,000 today. So I think one could call that ethnic cleansing. You know, 99% of the population in Arab states has actually left. So let's have a look at this chart here, and you can see that communities that had hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of Jews in 1948, today you can count them on the fingers of one or two hands. And some countries have no Jews at all. For instance, Algeria went down from 140,000 to none. The same in Libya, no Jews there at all. My chart is already out of date because Egypt, I'm reliably informed, only has about 6 elderly widows left. In Iraq, there are 5 people. And Syria, I learned last week, has 3 Jews left. The other thing you notice about this chart is how very old these communities were. And they go back really to biblical times, well before the establishment of Islam and the Arab conquest. So these communities go back to the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd century before the Christian era. So they really are indigenous. The region actually has almost as much Jewish history as the land of Israel itself. For instance, 17 biblical figures are buried in the Middle East, and 5 biblical prophets. One of these prophets was the prophet Ezekiel, and his shrine is located about two hours south of Baghdad. And in its heyday, the community used to go on pilgrimage to Ezekiel's shrine. About 5,000 used to go, 5,000 Jews used to go there around the time of Shavuot, and also between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. And the picture on the left shows you the scribes who would write blessings and prayers for the visiting pilgrims. The picture picture on the left, the scribes, the picture on the right, you can see a detail from the Hebrew inscriptions decorating the burial chamber of the tomb of Ezekiel. Now, as far as we know, these inscriptions are still there, but look what's happened to the place. It is now almost unrecognizable. A Shiite mosque has been built on the site, dwarfing the original site of Ezekiel's shrine. And the character of the place has been transformed beyond recognition. We know that the tomb itself has been encased in a sort of trellis, which is sort of typical of Shiite shrines. There are inscriptions all over the place to the Imam Ali. And if a Jew turned up wanting to go and visit the shrine of Ezekiel, he wouldn't be allowed in. Because first of all, Jews are not allowed into holy Muslim shrines. And secondly, the Shiites have a particular view of Jews as untouchable, as Jews would actually defile the holiness of this place. And this, in a way, is what's happened to a lot of Jewish heritage in the Middle East and North Africa. Synagogues have been converted into mosques or to other purposes, or they've been allowed to crumble to dust. Highways have been built over Jewish cemeteries. Many of them are neglected and vandalized. And there's almost nothing left of almost 3,000 years of Jewish presence in this region. The one exception to this really is Morocco, where the king has invested a lot of money in preserving Jewish sites, Jewish synagogues, Jewish quarters, Jewish cemeteries. But the Jewish population of Morocco is only 1% of what it used to be. And these synagogues will be nothing more than empty buildings in a generation or so. So let's look at relations between Jews and Muslims over the 14 centuries that they lived in the same region. I think there is a confusion between symbiosis and coexistence. Because the Jews had been there such a very long time, they influenced the surrounding community, and they made their mark on the region's culture. And of course, they influenced Islam. Judaism and Islam are very close. Hebrew and Arabic are very close. And there is a sort of symbiosis of cultures. But this is not the same as a coexistence, which assumes a certain equality in the relationship. Jews were never considered equal to Muslims. In fact, they were considered inferior. And they were known by the name Dhimmi, And the Dhimmi status, what characterizes the Dhimmi status was that the non-Muslims, that's notably the Jews and the Christians, had to pay a tax to the ruler of the day. And the ruler had to protect the Dhimmi. And you might well ask yourself, protect against what? And very often the Jew and the Christian might encounter hostility. There were occasional riots. There was pressure to convert to Islam. And the ruler of the day, it was his responsibility to defend these Jews who were not allowed to defend themselves. So it's a bit like subcontracting your right to self-defense to the mafia by paying them protection money. Now the Dhimmi status was not always universally applied. Some periods were better than others. Sometimes the Jews thrived under a benevolent ruler, but it was not always the case. And I will read you a short passage that illustrates the Dhimmi status. In a similar way to their Ashkenazi counterparts in medieval Europe, Jews in Morocco were debarred from certain occupations by the Islamic guilds. As in Europe, they performed certain necessary economic functions like money lending and associated tasks like metalworking, which were deemed reprehensible or unlucky by the non-Jewish majority. The Jews were given the most menial of tasks. One such job assigned to them was the salting of the decapitated heads of executed captives. In Yemen, the job of cleaning the sewers was done by a subcaste of Jews. In Egypt today, the Christian Copts are the rubbish collectors. In 20th century Iraq, Christians also did menial jobs in conformity with their lowly status, like cleaning septic tanks. The small Sephardi community of Palestine was so abased under Muslim rule that a contingent of Ashkenazi followers of the false messiah Shabbatai Tzvi, seeking refuge in Jerusalem in 1700, refused to put up with the humiliation suffered by the Sephardim. "The Arabs behave as proper thugs towards the Jews," one wrote. In Palestine, Jews were not allowed to worship freely at their holy places. The Mamluk rulers forbade them from treading beyond the seventh step on the staircase to the burial place of the patriarchs in Hebron. "Nothing equals the misery and suffering of the Jews of Jerusalem," wrote Karl Marx. "Turks, Arabs, and Moors are the masters in every respect." To be a Dhimmi was to be continually reminded of Islam's supremacy over Judaism and Christianity. Of course, Jews performed an essential function as commercial go-betweens and could and did rise to lofty positions as courtiers, sarafs, that's treasurers, and merchants. Some were fabulously rich, like Haim Fahi. But like him, these Jews could just as quickly fall into disfavor. Fahi had his nose cut off and his eye gouged out by a treacherous Ottoman governor and was subsequently assassinated. So the Dhimmi status, as I said, was not always universally applied. It always depended on the ruler of the day, and some were better than others. But the one thing you could say was that the Dhimmi status was always precarious, and you never really knew what the future would bring. All this changed quite radically in the 19th century, when the European colonial powers started increasing their influence in the Middle East and North Africa. In fact, there was a revolution, you might say. They began to insist on equal rights for Jews and Christians. And in 1856, the Dhimmi rules were abrogated, and the Jews and Christians became equal citizens with the Muslims. Now, this was not always the case. It was certainly true of the Ottoman Empire, but places which were not actually under Ottoman rule still continued to apply the Dhimmi rules well into the 20th century. For instance, in Yemen, right up to the 1950s and the great emigration of the Jews then. For instance, in Iran, up to 1925. For instance, in Morocco, up to the beginning of the French Protectorate in 1912. But there began actually a very good era for Jews in Muslim countries. About the same time as the colonial powers were increasing their influence, there was a group of French Jews who decided to set up a network of schools. And this network was actually revolutionary because it began to educate Jews who up until then had only received a religious education. And it taught them how to really survive in the modern era. And so Jews began to learn languages, they learned science, they learned maths. Girls began to be educated. And this network of schools was called the Alliance Israélite Universelle, and it had a fantastic impact because when the British and the French started setting up their protectorates and their mandates, the Jews were then in a position to become the backbone of the colonial administrations, and they began to dominate commerce and finance and trade. In fact, there were two finance ministers who were Jewish, one in Iraq and one in Egypt under British control. And this, in fact, ushered in a golden age for the Jews, and a middle class began to emerge. And you find when you speak to Jews from Arab countries, they often look back at their childhood as, you know, with nostalgia, because they remember, you know, a comfortable life, maybe with servants, nice houses, orange blossom on the trees, and a really golden era. And in the arts as well, Jews became very prominent. And here you see some examples of Jewish musicians who are still well known in the Arab world today. In Iraq, in fact, practically all the musicians were Jewish. Not because they were any better at playing music than the Muslims, but an imam had declared a ban on Muslims learning or playing music. And so the Jews stepped into the breach. And out of 250 musicians in the Iraq Broadcasting Orchestra, only three musicians were actually Muslim. The rest were Jewish. Now, the lady bottom left is Lillian Levy Cohen. Her stage name was Camellia, and she was a famous film star in the 1940s in Egypt. And I have her here on the front cover of my book. Now, Lillian Levy Cohen was very prolific. She made 18 films in the space of about 3 years. Because Egypt was then the sort of Hollywood of the Middle East. But sadly, at the age of only 21, she was killed in a plane crash. And rumor had it that she was the mistress of King Farouk of Egypt, and that he had her killed. But that is probably just a conspiracy theory. And the lady on the right, bottom right, is a famous Jewish singer called Salima Murad, who actually stayed on in Iraq after the great immigration of 1950. Right, so we move on. But this era, this golden age, was actually quite short. I forgot to mention that what it did was it actually inverted the whole dhimmi situation. So instead of being inferior, the Jews became superior to the Muslim majority, and they were getting all the best jobs. So this caused tension and resentment with the Muslims, which I think is quite an important factor in explaining the Arab-Israeli conflict today. But the colonial era was quite brief and did come to an end really in the 1930s and 1940s. And it came to an end because of the rise of anti-Semitism. There was one type of anti-Semitism, which is actually often not really mentioned, and that is colonial anti-Semitism. Algeria was a country which was under French control. It was actually considered part of metropolitan France, and the Jews were granted French citizenship there. But this was really too much for the settlers in Algeria, and there was a great deal of racism there. And Edouard Rumont, who was actually the parliamentary representative for Algiers, and he is really famous because he spearheaded the campaign against Captain Dreyfus, who, as you know, was wrongly accused of betraying France. And there was a trial, and he was sent to Devil's Island. Eventually, he was released. The colonial powers also were very happy to exploit the Jews for what they could get out of them, for their talents, skills, and languages. But at the end of the day, except in Algeria, they were not really prepared to give citizenship to the Jewish minority. And in times of trouble, the colonial powers were not always ready to protect the Jews either. And we have several instances of riots and even massacres, which the forces of law and order were reluctant or late in quelling. One example is the Farhud massacre in 1941. That was an incident, it was a massacre of upwards of 200 Jews, maybe as many as 600, we don't know the exact figures. The rioters were allowed to murder Jews over a period of 2 days in June 1941, while the British army stood at the gates of Baghdad, and they could have easily quelled the riot, they could have intervened, but they didn't. There was, and I should mention at this stage also that the ultimate betrayal was when the pro-Nazi Vichy governments were established in North Africa during World War II, and they began to implement the first stages of the final solution, stripping Jews of their rights. There was another form of anti-Semitism that arose in the early 20th century, and that was the anti-Semitism associated with Arab nationalism. Arab nationalist parties began to emerge. They were blood and soil parties. They wanted independence for Arab countries. But they wanted to exclude anyone who was not Muslim or and not Arab. So these minorities found themselves being ushered, marginalized and ushered towards the exit. And this symbol here, this flag here, is that of the Syrian Social Nationalist Party, which was very much influenced by Nazism at the time. And the symbol will probably remind you of something. And this party actually exists today. And there was another party called the Ba'ath Party, also influenced by the Nazis. And that too exists today. And the leader of the Ba'ath Party in Syria is none other than Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria. Another form of anti-Semitism arose at this time, and this was the anti-Semitism associated with Islamism. Now, we hear a lot about Islamism today. We hear a lot about Daesh or ISIL or ISIS, or, Islamic State. We hear about Al-Qaeda, we hear about Al-Nusra, and we hear about Hamas. Which is actually a branch of the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood is not a recent phenomenon. The Muslim Brotherhood was actually founded in 1928 by the gentleman in the fez, Hassan al-Banna. And what the Muslim Brotherhood wanted to do was to re-establish the caliphate, which had come to an end with the end of the Ottoman Empire at the end of World War I. And what they wanted to do was overthrow the Western governments in Arab countries and turn the clock back. And they wanted the Jews to revert to their dhimmi status, living at the mercy of the Muslims. And I'd argue that anti-Semitism was really at the very core of the Muslim Brotherhood's philosophy, because the Jews really stood for everything they hated. The Jews stood for modernity and change and for civil rights and women's rights and minority rights. And the Muslim Brotherhood started agitating against the Jews as early as the 1930s in Egypt, when they incited riots against the Christian Copts and the Jews. And they soon identified the Jews with the hated colonial powers. And by 1945, they had about 1 million men under arms. And the Muslim Brotherhood started bombings and violence. In fact, they believed that violence would help them achieve their objectives. So a three-way alliance was established between the Muslim Brotherhood and the Germans on the one hand, and the Palestinian Mufti Haj Amin al-Husseini on the other. The Germans were busy intriguing in the Middle East throughout the 1930s. Here you see a picture on the right of Fritz Grobber, who was the German ambassador to Baghdad. In the 1930s, Mein Kampf was translated into Arabic and serialized in Arabic newspapers. The Germans funded the activities of the Muslim Brotherhood, and they also financed the activities of the Mufti of Jerusalem, Haj Amin al-Husseini. He was a Zionist. He concocted a sort of new form of anti-Semitism that combined sort of traditional prejudice against the Jews that you could find in the anti-Jewish verses in the Quran, and a new type of anti-Semitism that was actually influenced by European and even Nazi anti-Semitism. And this held that the Jews were the epitome of evil and should be fought at all costs. And he and the Muslim Brotherhood effectively declared war against the Jews, not just in Palestine, but wherever they went in the Arab world. Right, and the Mufti was actually sent into exile by the British in 1939. He spent 2 years in Baghdad inciting the local Arabs against the Jews. And he never ceased trying to overthrow the pro-British government there. Eventually, he and a group of pro-Nazi Iraqis succeeded in overthrowing the pro-British government in April 1941. The pro-Nazi government was short-lived, but it culminated in a terrible massacre, the one I mentioned earlier, the Farhud massacre of June 1941, in which up to perhaps 600 Jews died, and there was extensive looting, and it was a terrible shock to the Jewish community who had not known anything like it. Now, the Mufti fled Baghdad. He eventually ended in Berlin, where he spent the rest of the war broadcasting anti-Jewish propaganda. And you can imagine that this had quite an effect on the population in Arab countries, who were mainly illiterate and easily swayed. And the message that the Mufti broadcast to the Arab population was, kill the Jews wherever you find them. Here you see his famous meeting with Hitler in November 1941. And the object of this meeting was really to get Hitler's permission to manage the extermination of the Jews, not just in Palestine, but all over the Middle East, because he was convinced that the Nazis were on the path to victory and the task of getting rid of the Jews would fall to him. But thankfully, that was not to be. The Allies won the Battle of El Alamein in 1942 and started reversing Nazi gains. But the Mufti of Jerusalem was also responsible for setting up Muslim SS divisions. This he did in Bosnia and Albania in the former Yugoslavia. And here you see on the right-hand side a picture of the soldiers, the SS soldiers at prayer. There is a myth that the Holocaust did not affect Jews in North Africa and the Middle East. But as I mentioned earlier, there were pro-Nazi Vichy governments in place in Morocco, in Algeria, in Libya, and there was a fascist government in Libya. In Tunisia, the country came under direct Nazi control for 6 months in 1942. And the top picture shows you Jewish men being marched off to labor camps with their shovels. Thousands of Jews were sent to these camps, and the Nazis did start to implement the first stages of stripping them of their rights, dispossessing them of their property, and using their forced labor. The second picture, the one on the right, shows you Libyan Jews, who are actually returning to Libya after the war. And these Jews had been sent off to Bergen-Belsen. And it's not well known that about 800 Jews of mainly British nationality were deported to the continent of Europe and ended up in concentration camps. There was a particularly horrible concentration camp in Libya at a place called Jado, near the capital Tripoli, and about 600 Jews died there of starvation or typhus. Also not well known, there were labor camps in Morocco on the border with Algeria. And here you see some of the pictures of what's left of them. These camps were in the desert. The inmates were building the Trans-Sahara Railway. There's not much left of these camps today. So the big question, one of the big myths, is what came first, anti-Zionism or anti-Semitism? And there is this myth that relations were very good between Jews and Muslims until Israel was established in 1948. But here you see an example of a pogrom that occurred in 1912 in the Moroccan city of Fez. And Morocco in particular has a very good image today. And Moroccan Jews are amongst the first to praise the King of Morocco for protecting them and for being a hero during World War II. And this sort of thing. But actually, if you look into the history of Morocco, Morocco has one of the worst records for pogroms against its Jews. And I would say that minorities in the Middle East actually have had a terrible time of it. They have suffered terribly from persecution. And these minorities, for instance, the Yazidis, the Copts, the Assyrians, they haven't had an Israel of their own. So fast forward to 1948, Israel is declared, 7 Arab countries declare war on it, and almost simultaneously, they declare war against their own Jewish minorities. We know that 7 Arab League states were actually planning to strip their own Jews of their rights and dispossess them of their property even before Israel was declared. Violence did break out in several Arab countries, and Zionism became a crime, punishable by prison or even execution. The problem was, how do you define Zionism? Was being caught in possession with a letter from Palestine, was that Zionism? Was wearing a watch Zionism, because Jews who were perhaps amongst the more affluent people in an Arab country would wear wristwatches, and they were being accused of sending secret signals to the Zionists with their watches. And so policemen would arrest these Jews, they would confiscate the watch, and the policeman would get to keep it. This document you see here is a laissez-passer issued to an Iraqi Jew in 1950. 1950 was a short window for the Iraqi Jews to actually leave Iraq. Pressure had been building up because these Jewish populations of Arab countries were effectively hostages. They hadn't been allowed to leave. So eventually the Iraqi government relented and let the Iraqi Jews leave legally, And this this period actually lasted for about a year before the gates slammed shut again. And likewise, in Yemen, a deal was reached with Israel to airlift the Jewish population out of Yemen. The Libyan Jews also managed to leave. About 90% of the community came to Israel. Later in 1956, the Egyptian Jews were expelled quite dramatically, and 25,000 of them left the country. Now, what's remarkable about this document is it allows the bearer to leave the country, but not to return. There's a stamp there which says one way, no return in Arabic. So effectively, the person with this document is not allowed to come back. They were expelled. So as well as losing their nationality, these Jews also lost their property. There was mass dispossession. They left the country with one suitcase and 20 dinars in their pockets. In Egypt, there was quite a wealthy class of Jews. This is an example of the residence of the Zuckerman family, and it is now the Swiss Embassy in Cairo. And here you see, this is taken from an Israeli article, actually, which lists all the Jewish properties that you could find around Tahrir Square in Cairo, right in the center of Cairo. A lot of foreign embassies were previously Jewish residences. For instance, the residence of the Russian ambassador was the home of Joseph Nissen, and it now houses the modern Russian embassy. The Victor Castro's palace is now Jehan Sadat's residence. Emil Zikov's house is now the Pakistani embassy, and then you've got the South Korean embassy, the German embassy, the Canadian embassy, the Dutch embassy. All these embassies were once Jewish homes. And I'll tell you a little story, if I may. Mrs. Castro, whose house is now lived in by Jehan Sadat, the widow of Anwar Sadat, the president of Egypt, was listening to Jehan Sadat give a lecture in New York. And she went up to her at the end of the lecture and said, "Oh, that was a lovely lecture. You know, I'm from Egypt too." And Jehan Sadat said, "Oh, that's wonderful. You must come back and visit. My house is your house." And it was, literally. So what happened to these Jews who had to leave? Well, the vast majority, that's 650,000 Jews out of 850,000, came to Israel. And Israel at the time only had about 600,000 people living there. It was a very poor developing country, and it didn't have the resources to take in all these people. It didn't have the accommodation, it didn't have the jobs, it didn't even have the food. And there was rationing at that time. So it had to put them in tent camps or ma'barot. And here you see a family living in a tent camp. Some of these ma'barot lasted up to 10 or even 13 years. I mean, they were not tent camps for long. They kind of developed into tin huts or wooden huts. And slowly they became towns, like, for instance, the town of Sderot, which we hear a lot about, the target of missiles from Gaza. That's started life as a ma'abara, a tent camp. And there are many towns in Israel which started life as ma'abarot. The integration process was extremely difficult in the 1950s and 1960s. It was a terrible time for a lot of them, but eventually they managed to assimilate into Israeli society, and you could now say that the integration was a success. And Mizrahi Jews are represented in every field of Israeli life and society. There are even ministers of Moroccan origin in the Israeli government. I think a third of all the ministers in the present government, coalition government, actually have roots in Morocco. And this is an invitation that was issued to a wedding in a ma'abara, in the tent camp. And the little invitation says, please come to our wedding in tent number, in hut number 10 or something. The question is, why has this story not been told? Why is it not known? And this artist, Mir Gal, prepared this artwork to illustrate the fact that only 10 pages in an Israeli school textbook were devoted to the history and heritage of Jews from Arab countries. All this is beginning to change slowly. In the last few years, the Israeli government has woken up to the necessity of and the importance of telling this story. And in 2010, the Knesset passed a law saying that no peace settlement could be reached unless there is compensation for Jewish refugees from Arab countries and Iran. We also have a date in the calendar. November the 30th has been designated as the day to remember the exodus of Jewish refugees from Arab countries and Iran. And I would certainly urge you in South Africa to commemorate this date. It's very important that this exodus should not be forgotten. It's important for peace and it's important for reconciliation. I would just leave you with this thought, and that is that we're accustomed to referring to the Middle East, and North Africa as the Arab title to political rights. But the region is really a patchwork of different ethnicities, religions, sects, and groups. And some of these groups have been asking for self-determination, asking for their own states for decades. For instance, the Kurds have been clamoring for their own state since 1923. But only the Jews have been lucky enough really to achieve this. But they shouldn't be seen as an anomaly in the region, as interlopers. They are indigenous and they're an authentic part of the region. And so I'll just leave you with this thought that, in fact, the lesson from what has happened to minorities is really that in order to protect yourself, you really need your own sovereign state and the power to defend it. And thankfully, we do have Israel today. So thank you very much indeed for listening to me. I'm very happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Lyn. Thank you. I'm sure I speak for everybody when I say that was really interesting and just such a depth of knowledge into the subject. So thank you for that. We encourage everybody to type their questions into the chat, and we will get to those in a moment. But before we do that, we'd just like to tell you about our upcoming events. On Sunday, the 9th of August at 7:30, we have Women's Day Warriors. Join us as we get up close and personal with some of South Africa's and Israel's female warriors with some amazing panelists. So please make a note of that. And then on the 12th of August, we have showcasing our South African community with the Jewish Agency and P2G. So with that, I'd like to hand over to Galia, who will be handling the Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you, David. And Lyn, I must reiterate David's words and just thank you as well. You've touched on some things that are unfortunately a little bit forgotten and so, so significant, so important for us to hear. So thank you so much for your presentation. We really appreciate it. For our Q&A session, as David has already said, if you would like to ask Lyn a question, then please go ahead and type it into the chat. And what I will do is I will either ask the question or I'll call on you to ask the question. So that is the way we're going to do it. So while we're giving people a chance to type their questions, Lyn, I think I'm going to be a little bit cheeky and jump in first here, because I actually have something that I was wondering about while you were speaking. And that was, you mentioned some of the biblical sites that are in these countries. And I was just wondering if there was any international efforts in place to try and preserve them, or what was happening to them?
Well, not a great deal has been happening, unfortunately. There is an effort to restore the tomb of Nahum in northern Iraq, but none of these sites have really been designated as protected by UNESCO. And certainly the fact that the Muslim Shiites were able to change the character of Ezekiel's tomb, and this happened very recently in the last 5 years, and there was no international outcry, I think means that the international community really does not care and is not prepared to do anything about it. And then we have incidents like, for instance, there was an attempt to set fire to Esther and Mordechai's tomb in Iran. This happened only a few months ago, and I've yet to hear any international organization, protest against that. The only exception to this is in Morocco. There are rabbis, saints' tombs, they're called, and actually Muslims do worship at these tombs as well as Jews. So there is a chance that these saints' tombs will be preserved for the future. But for the rest of the region, it's not looking very hopeful. There have been examples of synagogues that have been restored. For instance, the synagogue in Alexandria, the Nebi Daniel synagogue, was recently restored, and to much fanfare, the government spent millions of dollars restoring it. And you may have heard about this synagogue. But they're doing it really to foster, to promote tourism.
And if I can interrupt here, when they had the reopening ceremony, they didn't invite the Jews.
Yeah, that's right. So it was basically an inauguration orchestrated by the Ministry of Tourism, which tells you everything you really need to know. Mm-hmm. The Jews did have their own inauguration the following month. But these Jews came from outside, they were visitors, and they went home at the end of 3 days or whatever it was. And certainly the Egyptian synagogue will never be in use.
Oh, thank you, Lyn, for that. Sounds like a little bit of a mixed bag, like some good news there, but like you say, not the most optimistic forecast for a lot of those sites, which is very sad indeed, actually. I'm wondering if we could please unmute Maxine Boyd. Maxine has a question she would like to ask Lyn.
Am Unmuted. Hi, everybody. Hi, Lyn. Thanks for the absolutely fascinating talk. I do have a bit of a vested interest because I have a daughter-in-law whose mother and grandmother all had to leave, and they were in the Mabarot in the 1950s. Okay? But what I want to know, now that ISIS has been virtually defeated and the caliphate has collapsed, has the Iraqi relationships with Israel improved to the extent that they can now be regarded as one of the more moderate Arab states like Saudi Arabia?
You're asking about Iraq in particular?
Yes, yeah, specifically Iraq. Yeah.
Okay, well, Iraq is an interesting case because ever since the Arab Spring in 2011, there has been more freedom for Iraqis to express themselves. And they've been undergoing a kind of wave of nostalgia for the days when they had a Jewish community. And this particularly has affected middle class Jews, not Jews, middle class Muslims, a lot of them very young. And they are thirsting for information on social media about the Jews. And a lot of them sound very sympathetic and they're trying to get to know Iraqi Jews living outside Iraq. But the government remains as hostile as ever to Jews. And I'm afraid, you know, as long as there is this hostility, I don't think we can make progress. In Egypt, if I may just mention that, it's the opposite problem. The population is really hostile. But the government is actually quite friendly. And in fact, there's a lot of security cooperation, as you know, between Egypt and Israel. So I hope that answers that.
Thank you, Lyn. I'm just going to read another question here. This is from Esther Levitas, has asked a question. She says, can Jews own property in any of these Arab countries?
Well, the Jews who still live in Arab countries own property, but as soon as they leave, as soon as they leave the country, that property is often seized, or they can't sell it, or something. For instance, in Iraq, what's happened is the Jews were actually nationalized and their property nationalized. So as long as they were living in Iraq, they could own the property. The minute they left Iraq, they had to leave the property behind. And they haven't been compensated. You know, I know very few cases of compensation. Yeah.
Thank you, Lyn. Okay, could we please unmute Gilda Galvad, who has a question to ask? Just give us a moment while we unmute Gilda so she can ask her question.
Hi, that was wonderful. Thank you so much for such an interesting talk, which I knew little about. Is it safe to go to Morocco as a Jew?
Yes, it is safe. And actually, Jews are largely allowed to practice. You can walk around with a kippah on your head and you won't be molested. And tourism is extremely important to Morocco. It's the second biggest currency earner. In Jewish sites, Jewish culture is absolutely central to Moroccan tourism. So I would say it is safe to travel to Morocco. The problem with Morocco is they have quite a big problem with Islamists, which you don't actually hear about. And I think that all these countries are sort of give the appearance of being stable and everything, but things can actually change from one day to the next. And I think there is a chance that you never know that the king might be deposed one day. I mean, it's hardly a democracy. And if something happens to the king, then the Jews in Morocco are finished, basically. Their fate is tied to that of the king. But as a tourist, I think there isn't a problem. And actually, Israeli tourists, you know, of Moroccan origin do visit. Thousands of them do come to Morocco every year.
Thank you, Lyn. Okay, look, we've got two more questions that I'm gonna have. So could we please unmute Chris Eden? And then after Chris Eden, we have a question from Victor Boyd.
Good evening, Lyn. Thank you. That was fascinating. The whole issue of demitude, thank you for the explanation around how colonialism sort of suppressed it. But is it still a factor today in the interaction between Muslim communities and Jews? And specifically, does it influence the potential for some sort of settlement with Israel in the Middle East?
Oh yes, I think it is a very important factor, an underrated factor. I think the fact that Israel defeated the Arab states and has continued to defeat Arab states is a terrible humiliation, because Islam considers Jews as a defenseless minority. You know, and the fact they can actually not just defend themselves, but beat the combined might of the Arabs, that's been a terrible humiliation. And they haven't yet recovered from this, in my opinion. Also, I think they have a great deal of difficulty being a minority, you know, ruled by a Jewish majority, because that is not the way that Islam really planned it. You know, the Jews would always be a kind of fossilized minority that, you know, okay, so they're allowed to survive, really, because they're quite useful, but in fact, they are a relic of a previous religion, you know, previous civilization, and sooner or later, they're going to see the light and convert to Islam. That's the kind of attitude. So I do think demitude, it is a factor. It's certainly very important for the Islamists, for the Islamic fundamentalists, because they want nothing more than to re-establish Muslim control over what is now under Jewish rule, you know, and to have 1 inch of what they consider to be Muslim land ruled by a non-Muslim is anathema, and you know, they will fight to the death to reverse this situation. So yeah, and I think it is underrated as a fact. I don't think you know, peace initiatives really take this into account, that there's this deep cultural and religious kind of obstacle to peace with Israel.
Thank you, Lyn. And so we have our final question now from Victor Boyd.
Hi, thanks for unmuting me. I recently read that Israel has submitted a claim to 7 Arab countries, as well as Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, and Yemen, for assets that the Jews had left behind when they were kicked out of these countries. Close to $350 billion. And in contrast, the Palestinian authorities have also filed a claim against assets which the Palestinians either left or were forced to leave. We know these claims are all valid. What's the chances of these claims being settled?
Right. Well, the first claims by on the Jewish side, actually, there is a study being carried out at the moment by an accountancy firm. They're trying to quantify the value of Jewish property left behind in Arab countries. And there have been certain leaks in the press, you know, certain figures bandied about, but we don't actually know the final result of this. But the Palestinians have been producing figures of their own for years, some of them wildly exaggerated. I mean, the kind of accepted wisdom really is that the Jews lost far more than Palestinians did because they were an urban people. You know, they lived in cities and they lived in the center of town, and a lot of these cities, the land values have gone up considerably. So it is estimated that the Jews left perhaps lost about 50% more than the Palestinians. The question of compensation is a very tricky one. A lot of people think that it'll never actually come to fruition. People will not be compensated. Mm. Certainly the Jews will never see compensation. But there is a suggestion that an international fund could be set up. This was actually Bill Clinton's idea in the year 2000, when there were peace negotiations going on at Camp David. And he said there should be an international fund that would compensate refugees on both sides, both Jews and Palestinians. And that is possibly the best suggestion to come out of all this, because a country like Egypt can't afford to even feed its people, let alone pay compensation. They're terrified in case the Jews come back and reclaim their property. And they certainly probably can't afford it. They can't afford to compensate their Jews. And in fact, we're not even there yet, because the Arab states don't even recognize that they kicked out their Jews. You know, they say they were left of their own free will, or the Zionists made them leave, or something like that. So we're not even near talking about compensation. But if we were, I don't think the Arab countries would be in a position to actually pay out compensation. So I think this idea of the international fund is probably the best solution. Does that answer your question? Yes, he's been muted.
Thank you. And thank you for those questions. I must say, I really enjoy this Q&A session. I think it's really great to be able to ask questions and to be able to engage with our speaker. And somebody like you, Lyn, who's so knowledgeable and has so much understanding and insight on these issues, it's been a real treat to be able to engage with you and have this Q&A time. So thank you to those of you who have posed questions, and thank you, Lyn, for all of your tremendous answers. Before I hand over to Ben Levitas, who is going to close and give a word of thanks, I would like to just hand over to Rodney Mazinsa, who would just like to say one or two things. And Lyn, you said at the beginning of all of this how we met in the very north of Scotland, and here we are on Zoom, so who knows where we'll meet again, but it's been lovely to see you and to see your husband again, and thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. And thank you,
Galia. And a most interesting and fascinating talk. I looked at my watch a moment or two ago, and I can't believe that the time has flown by so swiftly. But of course, there are people who are members of the professional staff of the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council, and I do not want to let an opportunity slip by without acknowledging them and thanking them for their hard behind-the-scenes work. I'm talking specifically about Julie Berman, Galia Tregenza-Hall, Yvette Rosenberg, Natasha Salkinder, Maxine Boyd, and of course not from Cape Town, but we wish he was here, David Fleminger, who kept us all in line and kept this thing going very smoothly. And I would just like to make an appeal to everybody, get the book. It's a great read, And everything that you heard today has been expanded in the book. And I think you, like me, you won't be able to put it down. It's a page turner. Thank you, everyone.
It's lovely.
Thank you, Rodney. And I might just thank you for your thanks. And we also remember Lisa up in Johannesburg for all of her efforts as well.
Thank you for that.
And so I'd like to hand over to Ben Levitas, who is the former chairman of the South African Zionist Federation Cape Council, and who sits on our media committee. So over to Ben.
Thank you, Galia. Thank you. And also, I think one of the staff that we need to compliment was Maxine Boyd, who actually suggested that we get hold of Lyn. And I think it's been fantastic to have Lyn speak to us about 2,000 years of history across the Arab world of Jewish communities, diverse Jewish communities, the history, the erasure of their history. It has been absolutely fascinating, and it's really something that I think we all as Jews need to know about and need to be proud of. And Lyn has covered this, the breadth of the different societies, absolutely brilliantly, in great detail, in a very humane fashion, looking at anti-Semitism and looking at Zionism as well. And for this, we owe her a debt of gratitude as the Jewish community. So also, thank you very much, Lyn, for giving us your honorarium, for giving that to Safi, which you saw in the movie. The little excerpt was to help the poor and the needy in our society. And for that, we are very thankful for your graciousness and your generosity. I also want to invite people to your website, which you raised, which you mentioned, www.harif.org. If you want to follow those 17 webinars that you presented, as well as further ones.
Yes.
And again, I'll just echo the words of everybody that's been on this program, thanking everyone, and also for participating so wonderfully with brilliant questions. Thank you very much.
Pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Lyn, and everybody who contributed. Really great to have you all here. Just before we wrap up and I end the meeting, I did forget to mention one upcoming event. We have Cooking Up with Israel at Home. Join us for another tantalizing cooking session with South African Israeli foodie Maria Salomon. He's always fun. He's a great raconteur, and I'm sure you'll enjoy that. Last thing before we go, once again, if you can, please do donate to the SAFI COVID Relief Fund. They're the details. I will be ending the meeting shortly. But for now, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
You want a cup of tea, yes?
Please.